Considering the sage and assault, what says the Troy, the Borg, Britnid, and Brent, to Brondes and Askers, the Tulk that the trammers of Trezun there wrought, was treed for his treachery, the truest on earth. It was Aeneas the Athel and his heiche kinde, that sithen depressed provinces and patroons become well neigh of all the well in the west eels. Fro richer Romulus to Roma riches in Sweden, with great bobance that Burke he beggars upon first, and nevenes hit his own anon as hit new hat. Tereus to Tuscan and Teldes beginners, Langebert in Lombardy lifters up homes, and fair over the French flood, Felix Brutus, on money bonkers full broad, Bretagne he centres with wind, where wear and rack and wonder be seethers that's wont therein, and oft both the bliss and blunder full scared had skifted sin.
Towards the end of the 14th century, one of the greatest works of English literature was composed by a poet whose name remains unknown to us. Writing in a style that used structures that had flourished centuries before, and in a local dialect that would appear to have been unfamiliar to the court, the main target audience for poetic entertainment. French had been the aristocratic language of Britain since its conquest in 1066 by William of Normandy. But by the time this poem was written, French had all but given way to the London form of Middle English. This is a tongue that is clearly recognisable as a close relation to the language we use today. London-based Geoffrey Chaucer, a contemporary of the Gawain poet, was to make masterly use of Middle English in the Canterbury Tales and other works. Chaucer himself had held high rank in the court of King Edward III, and in his time, the Middle English used in the southeast region was already the language of Parliament. Chaucer's use of it may indicate that it was becoming the accepted language of the court. The language of the Gawain poet has been identified as belonging to Cheshire, a region in the northwest Midlands of England bordering on Wales. Its death as a dialect resulted in the poet falling from favour so that even his name has been lost to us, whilst Chaucer became acknowledged as the founding father of English poetry. The poem is written in a style that looks back to Anglo-Saxon literature, with its use of alliteration or the sequencing of words that stress the same sounds.
Sithen the sage and the assault what says it at Troia, the Borg, Britnid and Brent, to Brondes and Askers, the Tulk that the trammers of Trezun there wrought, what's treed for his treachery, the truest on earth. It what's Aeneas the Athel and his heir kinder, that sithen depressed provinces and patroons become well neigh of all the well in the west eels.
Interest is given to the rhythm by the employment of a break or caesura in each line.
Fro richer Romulus to Rome riches him sweeter, with great bobance that burk he beggars upon first, and nevenes hit his own anon as it knew hat. Tereus to Tuscan and Teldes beginners, Langebert in Lombardy lifters up homers, and fair over the French flood, Felix Brutus, on money bonkers full broad.
However, it is truly innovative, the poet applying what has come to be known as the bob and wheel technique, which he may have invented.
Bretagne he setters with wind, where wear and rack and wonder be seethers hath wont therein, and oft both bliss and blunder full skate had skifted sin.
The bob is the first of five rhyming lines, it being shorter, whilst the following four lines of equal length are the wheel. They come after a number of longer unrhymed lines which the Gawain poet uses with great flexibility. The work itself survived as a part of a manuscript which is now in the British Library in London, measuring 4.75 by 6.75 inches, together with three other poems of great artistic value: Pearl, Cleanness, and Patience. It is catalogued under the title Cotton Nero A.X, taking its name from the great Jacobean antiquary, Sir Robert Cotton, into whose collection it had entered by 1621. Most critics believe all four poems to be the work of the same writer. All are written in the same Cheshire dialect. All have strong religious foundation. Pearl concerns the apparition to the poet of a dead daughter who is now a queen in heaven. Patience tells the story of Jonah with an emphasis on his final submission to the will of God after being imprisoned in the belly of a whale. And Cleanness uses Noah, Abraham and Lot as examples of God's pleasure in sexual righteousness. In contrast, Gawain and the Green Knight, whilst shot through with religious illusions and ceremonies, is not concerned with biblical tales or heavenly apparitions. What is more, it stands out by the complexity of the moral response it demands of the critic, and like many more modern works, its resolution is ambiguous. Could the unsettled nature of the conclusion have any relationship to an unsettled society in which it was written? Our quest, like Gawain's, will take us through the turbulent borderlands of Wales and across Cheshire in our search for the answers. It will also be a journey back in time, in an attempt to shed light on the reasons why the unknown poet should have used this particular subject at this particular time, and in doing so, created a landmark in English literature. A monk from the North Welsh town of Bangor was the first to associate the capital of Richard's new principality with Arthur. Around 820, nearly 500 years before Richard's act enlarging the county, Historia Britonum, or the History of Britain, was written by the monk Nennius. It contains a reference to Arthur's ninth battle having been fought at the City of the Legions. Most scholars today believe this to have been the city of Chester. Its name in Welsh would have been Caerleon, and there is a town in Wales today that bears this very name, which was also a city of the legions. This is the Caerleon that Geoffrey of Monmouth chose to locate the court of King Arthur, later to be known as Camelot, and it has been suggested that the Roman arena, whose outlines remain today, might have provided inspiration for the Round Table. As noted, Geoffrey may have been under pressure to relocate Arthur's kingdom within the Marcher territories, and Welsh Caerleon would have fallen directly under the control of his patron, Robert, Earl of Gloucester. However, there has never been any suggestion that Chester itself was Arthur's Camelot. The Keys to Avalon locates his court in the town of Montgomery, in the northern Midlands of the Marcher lands, whose castle was one of the seats of the beheaded Earl of Arundel, so that unwittingly Richard may have annexed the true capital of his glorious predecessor. That the Gawain poet had no knowledge of this is clear from tracing the journey that Gawain undertakes in his search for the Green Knight. The King's Court in the poem is simply known as Camelot, and we are provided with no clues as to its location. The first named destination is Anglesey, an island in the extreme northwest of Wales, and Gawain's path can be traced eastwards thereafter. There would have been little point in his crossing Wales westward from eastern Montgomery, simply to double back on his journey at a more northerly point. Anglesey had played a central role in the history of North Wales. Not only was it the Druidic centre which the Romans had laid waste at the time of the Boudicca Rebellion, but Aberfraw, was the court of the powerful princes of Gwynedd, the rulers of North Wales, whose power had been directly pitted against that of the Earls of Chester and the English kings. The island was finally crushed under the heel of Edward I, who placed one of his most awe-inspiring castles here, at Beaumaris. Gawain's journey eastward would have taken him past other Edwardian strongholds, such as Conway, which even 100 years later had not been bettered. It is true that they would not have been there at the time of the historic Arthur, but our Sir Gawain is a true product of the 14th century, as a description of his armour and clothes makes transparently clear. He proceeds to Holyhead. By this time he has arrived in the land that came directly under the control of Richard II, and it is from this point that the journey is described in some detail, not so much by naming names as through evocative descriptions of the landscape. Whereas to this point the journey has taken a mere 10 lines, it will be another 80 lines before he arrives at the castle of Sir Bertilac, and although at the time he is unaware of it, is close to his journey's end. The reason for this distortion of time and space is likely to be that this is the landscape with which the Gawain poet was familiar. His dialect has been traced to within this area. As a bonus, this would be the countryside that his targeted audience, Richard and his household, would be most familiar with. The place called Holyhead in the poem must have been a crossing point of the Dee, close to Holywell. It is now part of Flintshire, but at the time was included within Richard's Principality of Chester. Holywell is named from a miraculous spring dedicated to St. Winifred, one of the wonders of Wales. This chapel would not have been here at the time of Sir Gawain's errand. It was constructed by the mother of the first Tudor king, Henry VII, at the end of the 15th century, 100 years after his quest. At the time of Richard, this sacred place shared top billing as a pilgrim's destination with Canterbury, whither Chaucer's pilgrims were to wend their way. Henry V was to give thanks for his victory at Agincourt by making a pilgrimage to its venerated waters. It gained its fame from a legend. In this, St. Winifred was courted by a Welsh chief, Caradoc, whose love she rejected due to her longing to dedicate her life to God. In rage, Caradoc beheaded her, and where her head fell, a spring sprang up from the ground. Fortunately, her uncle was also a saint, and as he happened to be passing by, when he blessed her, her head rejoined her body, and her life was restored. Crossing the Dee, Gawain entered the Wirral, which is now one of the most desirable residential areas of the northwest, so that it is difficult to see in it the wild country that the knight was to enter. Despite the fact that at the time all of the Wirral was part of the county of Cheshire, it is described as a wilderness and few who lived there had the love of either God or man in their hearts. Proceeding beyond the Wirral, the knight arrives in the borderland shared by the counties of Staffordshire, Cheshire and Derbyshire, consisting of over 150,000 acres of moorland, much of it used for pastoral farming today, but otherwise little changed from the days of Sir Gawain's search for the Green Knight. At its edge, it is a convoluted escarpment called the Roches, from the French word for rocks, roche, and it is here that Sir Bertilac's castle, Haute Désert, High Desert, lies, where Gawain is tempted three times, like Christ in the desert. Unlike Christ, he is unable completely to resist temptation. Fearing for his life, he makes his way to the Green Chapel, which is most commonly identified as a cave near Wetton Mill, to be reached at the end of a series of winding one-way country lanes. And here, for the first and only time in the poem, the poet provides great detail of the topography. He saw, as it were, a mound on a level space of land by a bank beside the stream where it ran swiftly. The water bubbled within as if it were boiling. He turned to the mound and walked around it. It had a hole at the end and at either side, and was overgrown with clumps of grass, and it was hollow within, as an old cave or the crevice of a crag. The representation of this isolated spot in the heart of a wilderness may be hard to credit on a summer day in the popular tourist venue of the Peak District, but it is worth remembering that even today, in winter, the unwary adventurer can get lost in the snow and freeze to death. This is the location where he bears his neck to the axe and is rewarded for his deceit by his humiliation. This is the land of our poet, and the Middle English dialect used is his own. The tale he tells unfolds within or adjoining boundaries of the new principality, which is his home country. Within this, not only does there lie a place of pilgrimage to a saint who loses her head, just as the previous owner of a good portion of the territory had lost his, it also may have included the court of the historical King Arthur, amongst a number of other places central to both the legend and the history of the once and future king. For example, there are claims that the Grail Castle was located nearby at Dinas Bran, just south of the principality, and right next to the Great Dyke built by the Saxon King Offa. With such a wealth of locations pertaining to Arthur, whether still capable of being identified as such or not, the area must have been rich in Arthurian folklore, and it would have formed the stuff of his childhood imaginings. His imagination would also have been fed by a number of tales of beheading contests, other than those provided by the local saint, or the execution of the Lord Appellant. Poems that involve Sir Gawain in such matches go back as far as the 13th century in French literature. Beyond him, of particular interest are the adventures of a knight named Caradoc in the Livre de Caradoc from the same period. This involves a giant knight, a challenge to a beheading, a return match to take place in a year onward, and Caradoc being released from his vows after surviving 3 counterfeit blows. However, none of these pioneering forays has the richness of narrative, meaning, or language of the English 14th century work, which weaves into the main decapitation narrative stories of enchantment and temptation, built on a wealth of technical detail with a strong moral foundation. King Arthur holds a feast at Christmastide. Not only is he portrayed as being fair of face, like Richard II, who is described by Adam of Usk as being as beautiful as Absalom. More ominously, we are told, even as a child, he liked neither to sit long at meat, so worked upon him his young blood and wild brain. A seeming giant arrives, greater than any man on earth. In estimating his height, we are also told that he is taller by the head than any in the hall. It is this head he has come to lose, and he issues a challenge to the knights. It is phrased in contemptuous language. I ask no fight. In faith here on the benches are but beardless children. His language reinforces the vision of the court of Camelot, being little better than a children's nursery. In a seeming failure of nerve, not one of the knights of the Round Table is eager to take up the stranger's suggestion, which is that they exchange blows with an axe, that the contender cut off the green knight's head, and in return, a year and a day hence, offer his own head to the axe. The paralysis of the court is rebuked by further insults from the giant figure, until Arthur, in a fit of anger, recklessly accepts the challenge himself. A strange picture is being painted of the kingly court, and one that might find its reflection within the Principality of Chester. Richard preferred art to war, and was apt to bestow his attention on personable favourites, rather than experienced, if unruly, barons. He was felt to be effeminate, though quite capable of brave, reckless, and sometimes ruthless action. Arthur, in his impetuousness, is prepared to put at risk his kingdom and his throne, as well as his life, an action that Richard was to repeat. It is at this point that Sir Gawain intervenes, describing himself as the weakest and the feeblest of wit. He adds, in an astonishing rebuke to the king, that this action is such folly that it beseems ye not to take it. Gawain has been forced by his uncle, King Arthur, to become his champion in a senseless venture. In this picture of a court incapable of caution, none of the knights, with the exception of Gawain, gains more than a passing mention, and few appear to warrant even that. Indeed, it is the Green Knight himself who appears closer to the knightly ideal. Even if he does not embody truly the virtues of courageousness and courteousness, there is something suspect in the contest in which he is offering to partake, and his courtly eloquence rapidly turns to sneering. In both these qualities, he is shown to be Gawain's inferior. What provided the poet with a model for this domineering visitor? Critics of the past looked to the old gods to provide clues to the Green Knight's identity and found it in the Green Man. A famous depiction of this being can be found at the cathedral at Winchester, the town that also provides shelter to the Round Table of Edward I. It is believed that the Green Man represents a residual memory of ancient fertility cults. Their rituals would involve ceremonies around the time of Christmas and Easter, and would include the ritual slaughter of a man whose death mirrored the death of the god in the depths of winter. This was necessary for the god to return to life with the spring. Bearing this in mind, in the 14th century, a green figure may still have been associated with something alien, wild, and certainly non-Christian. If so, although our Green Knight is not linked to any kind of godhead, for the poet's audience, the colour green would have had a number of negative associations. For all that, the knight is to be seen as no more, and perhaps less than, a knight, as the tale advances. Gawain takes up the axe, and the poet details what now takes place as the Green Knight bares his neck. The sharp blade shattered the bones, and sank through the white fat and cut it in two. The knight remained standing, then lifting up his head with blood spurting from his neck, he reminds Gawain of his commitment to meet him at the Green Chapel next New Year. He then leaves for places unknown. Like the Green Man, he has returned to life. A vivid description is provided of the passing year, and the time arrives for Gawain to fulfil his pledge. In a work filled with contemporary technical detail, we are treated to the arming of Gawain, with particular attention being paid to his shield. It consists of a golden pentagram on a red background, with an image of Mary, the Mother of Christ, on the inside. There is no doubt that it is given overt numerological significance in the poem, with each of the 5 points representing simultaneously Gawain's 5 senses, his 5 fingers, his 5 moral virtues, the 5 wounds of Christ, and the 5 joys which Mary had of her child, giving the shield the overall value of 5 times 5. The shield sometimes has been seen as holding a key to the whole tale. Later, we shall see that in a sense, it does. Although this is the first time in English literature that a pentagram gains a mention, its use as a mystical sign goes back to Mesopotamian times of around 3500 BC. Called the endless knot, it was the symbol for truth, and by medieval times, used as an amulet for warding off the attacks of demons. one standing within the pentagram was secure from all diabolic powers, which would certainly have included a green man. After a journey in search of the Green Chapel, during which Gawain fights dragons, wolves, bulls, bears, and wild boars, as well as battling foes at every stream crossing, he finds himself utterly lost. He has found no trace of the Green Knight. On Christmas Eve, he prays to the Blessed Virgin to lead him to some place where he can celebrate the holy season, and at once becomes aware of a mighty edifice, which is described as being a castle with so many pinnacles and so white that it might have been made of paper. Warwick Castle, one of the finest of the 14th century fortresses, provides a fine example of the elegance that these massive stone buildings had acquired by this time. He is greeted with a great kindness and courtesy, and the lord of the castle and his retainers are elated to find that they have Gawain himself in their walls. They have reason for rejoicing, for they are welcoming the foremost knight of the kingdom. The Gawain painted by the poet reverts to the pride of place granted him in the book translated by Geoffrey of Monmouth in the 12th century. It has little to do with the later deformations of the original character. By the 13th century, he is seen as a womanizer, with the ladies lining themselves up for his pleasure. Later still, by the time of Malory's Morte d'Arthur, he has become more than a ladies' man. He is not above the use of a modicum of force in gaining his sexual ends. More than this, he is essentially a man driven by hatred and a desire for revenge on his former friend Lancelot. By this time, Lancelot is perceived as the greatest knight of all in terms of military prowess, and Galahad greatly exceeds him in purity of heart, the two qualities in which Sir Gawain rules paramount in our poem. Despite his knightly virtues, and as if acknowledging the future Sir Gawain, the Lord Courtiers comment, "The knight shall bring us to the knowledge of fair manners, and it may be that hearing him we may learn the cunning speech of love." Gawain and the Lord greet and kiss each other, and he is introduced to the lady of the castle, together with her companion, an old crone. Gawain bows to the latter, but as for the lady of the castle, he took her lightly in his arms, and kissed her courteously, and greeted her knightly wise. Gawain accepts with great pleasure the invitation to pass Christmastide at the castle. The Lord's name is later declared to be Bertilac, and for the next 3 days, Gawain enjoys his hospitality, as he and that fair lady had much joy of each other's company through her sweet words and courteous converse. As he prepares for his departure, the Lord reveals that the Green Chapel, the object of his quest, is in the immediate vicinity, and Gawain gladly responds to his invitation to await his appointment at the chapel with a prolonged stay at the castle. To enliven the period of waiting, Bertilac suggests that a bargain be drawn up by which he and Gawain will each exchange with each other whatever they receive the next day, a contract that is then extended for the 2 further days at Haute Désert. The Lord will spend the days hunting, while Gawain will rest in bed, recovering from his journey and the subsequent revelry. Now begins one of the most astonishing literary feats of the English language, as the poet interposes scenes of the hunt with displays of courtship in Gawain's bedchamber, cutting between them in cinematic fashion. The technique appears to be without precedent, and although in the 20th century novel these shifts of time and space have become commonplace, its usage here is so masterly that it remains fresh. It heightens the tension by leaving one scene unfinished to arrive at another, creating what are popularly known as cliffhangers. It creates an illusion of speeding up the text, as the story is broken up into chunks that can be assimilated rapidly, and it leaves the audience in a somewhat breathless state of disorientation. This sense of speed is hardly modified by the detailed description of the butchering of the deer, which serves to reflect back to the anatomic description of the beheading of the Green Knight and points forward to Gawain's fate. What is happening is that, as agreed, Bertilac departs for the hunt each day. On the first, he shoots harts and hinds, on the second, he stabs a great boar, and on the third, he hunts down a fox. Gawain, throughout all this, is sleeping in bed until the lady of the castle awakens him and engages him in sex games, flattering his male ego to the point of suggesting that he would have a perfect right to rape any woman who found him resistible. The knight parries her various attacks with graceful courtesy, exchanging no more than a kiss with her on the first day, and two kisses on the second. On the third day, finding she cannot entice him to break his vow of chastity, she makes a further offer. This is that she will give him a green girdle that will make him invulnerable to any weapon, but only on the grounds that he will not reveal this to her husband. He agrees, though whilst Bertilac keeps to his word throughout, giving Gawain the spoils of the hunt each day, Gawain responds by passing on a kiss for the first day, two kisses for the second, but on the third crucial day, three kisses, concealing the gift of the girdle. The cross-cutting of the scenes highlights the difference between the valour and technical proficiency of Bertilac and his fellow huntsmen against the soft, luxurious life that Gawain is sharing with the ladies at the castle, a life that appears dangerously close to decadence. Might the poet be comparing the ways of the warlike barons with the artificial world of Richard and his close associates? Gawain has now put his faith in a girdle, a green girdle, given him by another man's wife, after he refuses her ring. Both items are obvious sexual symbols. This girdle, he will knot around himself to escape death at the hands of the Green Knight. Now taking precedence over the endless golden knot of the pentangle, protected by the Virgin Mary, and whose symbolic meaning stood for truth, the girdle has been obtained as a reward for untruth and deception. The purpose of the detailed description of the shield is now revealed. New Year has come again, and the poem continues to contrast the freezing cold of the winter world with the warmth and gaiety of the social gatherings. Gawain remains infatuated with the lady of the castle, whose advances he has evaded. May all good betide that lovely lady all her life long, as he prepares to meet his fate. Guided by one of the Lord's retainers, he makes his way through mists and snow in a land described as rugged and dangerous. Spurning the advice of his guide to flee the appointment, he comes to the Green Chapel, to be met by the screaming of steel on a grindstone. The Green Knight meets him and courteously compliments him on his valour, but nevertheless requires that he prepare himself for execution. At the first blow, he draws back the axe, accusing Gawain of having shrunk from it like a coward. The second, he withholds the blow, on the grounds that this was simply to ensure that Gawain would not flinch again. But the third attempt, it is narrated that he nicked him on one side so that the skin was severed. The sharp blade went down to the flesh through the white fat. Gawain explodes in anger, claiming that the contract has been fulfilled and threatening his opponent should he make a further attempt. The Green Knight, who turns out to be none other than Bertilac in a different guise, placates him, complimenting him on his courage. He reveals that Gawain has been the unfortunate dupe of a plot laid by the elderly companion of the lady, which had been aimed at the life of Arthur's wife, Guinevere. Nothing more is said about this, and it appears to be a red herring. The elderly companion is in fact Morgana Le Fay, the half-sister of Arthur, and incidentally, Gawain's aunt. Not only is she a great sorceress, we are told that she is a goddess, a strange addition to a work saturated with the Christian faith. It was she who sent Bertilac out in the guise of the Green Knight. The lady of the castle, whom Bertilac describes as having been Gawain's enemy, was encouraged by Bertilac himself to tempt Gawain. The knight errant is congratulated, having acquitted himself nobly, with one minor omission. For not giving up the girdle, he has received a flesh wound, as had been agreed by their arrangement. Overcome with shame and remorse, Gawain refuses to allow himself to be reconciled to his deceit. Despite the Green Knight's attempts to comfort him, Gawain is unable to come to terms with his own weakness, his only consolation being that the biblical patriarchs also proved capable of being beguiled by women. He refuses Bertilac's invitation to return to the castle to meet his aunt Morgana. His only request is that he be allowed to retain the girdle as a perpetual reminder to himself of his own failings. Back in Camelot, he continues to brood over his faults, although his fellow knights see in him such a shining example of knightly virtue that they all agree to take up the green girdle as a way of honoring Gawain. The poem ends recommending all to the mercy of Christ and with the words, On y soit qui mal y pense. Perhaps Gawain is not the only person who has been put to the test and been unable to distinguish illusion from reality. The lady of the courtship scenes does not create the impression of having been an unpleasant tease and manipulator of the worst kind. We only ever see one side of her, and the impression remains, though it should not, of her being simply a delightful flirt. Bertilac comes across as a man of honour and humanity, despite the fact that he is also the Green Knight, whose only function has been to bring about the death of a queen. We do not know whether he is really the Green Knight or Bertilac, or neither, since the nearest he comes to identifying himself is that at Haute Désert he is known as Bertilac. Nor can we be sure whether the retainers who show high regard and, we are told, love of Gawain are aware of or involved in his entrapment. And what about this attempt to kill Guinevere? Where did that come from? And what's this about Gawain's aunt, who is also a goddess? The world of the castle remains ambiguous, physically, metaphysically, and spiritually. It is possible that these nicely structured confusions reflect the meditations of the poet of the court of King Richard, of which he himself was a part. What he saw was beguiling, but lacking substance. The disorientation of perception and values that the poem ends with is the true destination of Sir Gawain's quest for the reader, beyond the Green Chapel. Arguments as to whether or not we are intended to judge Gawain as harshly as he judges himself, or whether we should follow Bertilac and the Round Table in their high regard for him, may be far from the mark. We have not been invited into a world of stable values, and are left with a feeling of foreboding that is only dispersed in the poem by finally throwing us all on the mercy of Christ. On y soit qui mal y pense. Who is thinking evil? Not Bertilac, not the superficial court of King Arthur. We are left with Gawain, eaten up with his own failings, and the uneasy poet observing and portraying the court of the unpredictable and impetuous Richard. He leaves us not with a judgment, but a feeling.